Good morning. First, I'd like to point your attention to the altar flowers this morning. The flowers here are given in celebration of today's infant baptism of Noah the Lewd. And so we welcome him and his family here with us this morning. Also like to note at the bottom of page 8 that we welcome Savannah Reese Arrington, 9 pounds, 12 ounces, 20 inches, born July 3rd, 2023. Her proud parents are Zach and Abby Ballas Arrington. Grandparents Tim and Sandy and great-grandma Winnie Powers. So we welcome her as well. Then at the top of the next page, page 9, mentioned this last week, just mentioned it again this week, that on Wednesday at 2, we're going to begin I don't like any of the words that go with this, study of prayer. We hear study and immediately we turn off. So it may be better an exploration of prayer, what it is, how it informs our life, how it can change us. What do we do when we can't pray? I think we've all been there at one time or another in our life. The practice of prayer, perhaps, is a better term for this. So if you're interested, come out and see what we're about here on Wednesday. Vacation Bible School is coming up Monday through Wednesday, July 24th to 26th. So put that on your calendar if it affects you, and consider bringing your children, grandchildren, great-grandchildren if you like. Then on the very last page of the bulletin, this evening, we have a Bible study here at the church. Tuesday, a 10 o'clock ladies' Bible study meets in the fellowship area. And again, Wednesday, 2 o'clock, practice of prayer. And now, if you would turn to page 3. To the call to worship. What shall we return to the Lord? We will lift up the cup of salvation.
And call
on the name of the Lord. Let us together worship God. For I am not ashamed of the gospel.
For it is the power of God to salvation.
In it, the righteousness of God is revealed.
As it is written, the righteous shall live by faith.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. Gracious God, we come to you on this day as your people, called here by your Spirit to worship, to open ourselves to your movement by the Spirit. We pray that together we might be a witness to the great love you show us in Jesus Christ, who lives with you in eternity through the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen. And now, and for those of you who are visitors, this is in the blue hymnals in the pews in front of you, hymn number 482, 482.
Thank you.
We come now to a point in our service where we consider who we are before God. That is, we take a few moments to think back through our lives, to see how we have lived, how we might live into the future, and how God might guide us. This is a time when we come before God in complete honesty. And that is a very difficult thing. For so often, we see ourselves as far more perfect than we are. So in this next few moments of silence, I would suggest that you take this time to be before God, to simply be as you are, as you know yourselves deeply within, and be open and be honest, and ultimately you will be purified. So let us go before God in silence. And now if you would turn to the prayer of confession, which is at the top of page 4, we will confess our sin together. Gracious God, our sins are too heavy to carry, too real to hide, too deep to undo. Forgive what our lips tremble to name, what our hearts can no longer bear, and what has become for us a consuming fire of judgment. Set us free from a past that we cannot change. Open to us a future in which we can be changed. And grant us grace to grow more in your likeness and image through Jesus Christ, the light of the world. And now let's realize that God sent Christ into the world as one of us. He lived a normal human life. He lived it with integrity. He lived it within God's will. He lived it as the way that a full human being can live his or her life. And he lived it without sin, that is, without disobeying God. In him, we have forgiveness. That is, in him, we are considered as he is. We are considered then sinless and pure and holy. So in Christ, know that you are forgiven and be at peace. Amen.
Be to the
Now let us pray. Gracious God, we have brought ourselves to you this morning. We have sung our praises. We have opened our hearts to you. And now we ask that you, to these open hearts, speak your word, your words that we hear as good news, that we might be yours now and always. Amen. We have this morning readings from Romans, a responsive reading for the psalm, and then a reading from the gospel. So please listen as Bill reads.
Good morning. A reading from the New Testament book of Romans, chapter 14, verses 7 through 19. Listen for the word of God. For none of us lives to himself, and none of us dies to himself. For if we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So then whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end Christ died and lived again, that he might be Lord both of the dead and of the living. Why do you pass judgment on your brother? Or you, why do you despise your brother? For we will all stand before the judgment seat of God, for it is written, As I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall confess to God. So then each of us will give an account of himself to God. Therefore, let us not pass judgment on one another any longer, but rather decide never to put a stumbling block or hindrance in the way of a brother. I know and am persuaded in the Lord Jesus that nothing is unclean in itself, but it is unclean for anyone who thinks it is unclean. For if your brother is grieved by what you eat, you are no longer walking in love. By what you eat, do not destroy the one for whom Christ died. So do not let what you regard as good be spoken of as evil. For the kingdom of God is not a matter of eating and drinking, but righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. Whoever thus serves Christ is acceptable to God and approved by men. So then let us pursue what makes for peace and for mutual upbuilding. Now join me, please, in reading responsively from Psalm 34 as printed in your bulletin. Come, O children, listen to me. I will teach you the fear of the Lord. Keep your tongue from evil and your lips from speaking deceit.
Turn away from evil and do good. Seek peace and pursue it.
The eyes of the Lord are toward the righteous, and his ears toward their cry.
The face of the Lord is against those who do evil.
When the righteous cry for help, the Lord hears and delivers them out of all their troubles. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers him out of them all. Affliction will slay the wicked, and those who hate the righteous will be condemned. And now a reading from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 13, verses 44 through 53. The kingdom of heaven is like a treasure hidden in a field, which a man found and covered up. Then in his joy, he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls, who on finding one pearl of great value, went and sold all that he had and bought it. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a net that was thrown into the sea and gathered fish of every kind. When it was full, men drew it ashore and sat down and sorted the good into containers, but threw away the bad. So it will be at the end of the age. The angels will come out and separate the evil from the righteous and throw them into the fiery furnace. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Have you understood all these things?" They said to him, "Yes." And he said to them, "Therefore every scribe who has been trained for the kingdom of heaven is like a master of a house who brings out of his treasure what is new and what is old." And when Jesus had finished these parables, he went away from there. Here end the readings. Thanks be to God.
We are going to take a look at these three parables in Matthew this morning, beginning with a story. This is one of my favorites. Some of you will have heard it, some of you may not have, but it's about two men who go to a Sufi judge. Sufi is the mystical arm of Islam, very different from the day-to-day life there. So he listens to the first man, and he hears his story, and at the end he says, "I believe that you are right." And then he listens to the second man, who tells exactly the opposite story. And he says, "I believe that you're right." And we Americans say, "What?" We are very used to right and wrong, light, dark, black and white. And we read and think in these categories most of the time. And so I want to put these parables in that sense, that on the surface they are the same, but underneath they are very different. And yet, they are the same. So if you're not confused now, we'll work through this and see where that takes us. Very briefly, the first parable. A man finds treasure in a field. In ancient times, people often buried their treasure in a field. This was the only safe place for it. There were not safety deposit box. There were not keys to their Bitcoin. There were not any safe places they could store things. And very few people they could trust, so they would bury it. Sometimes, like much of the world today, they went on a journey, they were disrupted by war or famine or something like that, and they went away and they never came back. And it was not extremely unusual for someone to find a treasure. And as it says, in order to claim it, he had to own the field. So he sells everything he has and buys it. And then the parable stops. We don't know what happens after that. We don't know if he left the treasure in the field. We don't know if he sold it. We don't know if he went to Vegas and had the time of his life. We don't know anything like that. We only know he bought the field. And in the field is the treasure. The second parable is very, very similar. A merchant searches for fine pearls, finds one of exceptional value, and buys it. And again, we stop because we don't know what they did with the pearl. The parables take us down a road of finding something of great value, finding a way to obtain it, and then they stop. We anticipate, which is what I did with the first man, did he go to Vegas or not? Typical American response, you win the lottery. Okay. And we might say, though, if we want to put these two parables together, that remember, they're about the kingdom of heaven. And the implication is that the kingdom of heaven is worth any price that we have to pay for it. and then they stop. Okay, the parables are also very different. In the first parable, the man is not looking for treasure. We don't know if he's wandering around in the field. We don't know if he's plowing. We don't know if it's just a lucky accident. But we do know he is not looking for the treasure when he finds it. We can assume, dangerously I suppose, but we can assume that he is poor. He has to somehow scrounge together everything that he has and sell it in order to buy this field, which is probably quite small. And then the treasure is a surprise. It's something totally unexpected, some dazzling and unsuspected event that just jumps into his life. In the second parable, the merchant is a seeker. She is someone who is sorting through pearls, or perhaps she has read Plato and Confucius and Buddha and Seneca, or in the modern day, Derrida and Foucault. But she's seeking. She's looking. And she searches through all of the world's most valuable objects and finds one of even greater value. She's rich enough to be able to sort through all these pearls, and pearls in the ancient world were of huge value. Some of them, at today's prices, would sell for millions of dollars each. But beyond that, is this one great pearl that she finds, and she's able to recognize it, which is interesting. And she has the resources to buy it. So on this level, the two are very different. A poor person stumbles upon something totally unexpectedly, and a rich person who is searching. And so it is with the kingdom of heaven. There are people who somehow stumble onto it. Maybe a street preacher. Maybe someone hands them a Bible. Maybe they just wake up one day and say, aha. There are people like that who suddenly realize what is most important in life. And it comes in all sorts of ways. Some are on a quest for it. Some are searching the great literature of the world, the great art of the world. Some are seeking out people they consider to be wise. And they too sometimes come across this one great pearl of wisdom or insight. And they are willing to give up everything to obtain it. In both cases, we're going to have a transformed life when we find this treasure or this pearl of great price. Now we come to the greater challenge of these three parables. And that is the parable of the net cast into the sea and collecting fish, and the fish being sorted through, and some are placed into baskets and some are discarded. To these people who had seen fishermen on the shores of the Sea of Galilee do this, this would have had some resonance. The fish are gathered indiscriminately. Think of a large dragnet. This is the way they still fish for the foods, the fish foods that we consume. And the very same process happens. They take the food fish and they discard the rest. And it's a very damaging process. But the parable like the first two, is not about fishing. It's about the kingdom of heaven. And this is what makes it a challenge to us. You see, the net gathers all the fish within its reach. Big fish, small fish, fish that can be eaten, fish that have to be discarded, fish that are good, fish that are trash fish, large, small, all types of fish. Which is a statement that the kingdom of heaven is open to all persons. And I know, Calvinists hate that. But it seems to me Jesus is the one who is most likely to be correct here. That the kingdom of heaven is like this huge net that catches all of us. And it foreshadows the church and is, I think, a lesson to us that within the church, our programs and resources should gather everyone. They should be available to all persons. Knowing that some people are merely wandering about. We see these persons all the time. They come, they stay with us for a few weeks, they tell us they are looking for the perfect church, which means one that agrees with them. Sorry, my sarcasm rules sometimes. But we see these people all the time. But we never know when they may discover the kingdom of heaven, whether here or someone else. That's not the point. We are to be open to all of them. Some of them are truly seeking the gospel, and we trust that they will find it. In all the challenges that the world has, we hope that they will at some point one day say, oh, this is it, and be transformed. And we know that some people simply want to have a nice place to get married, or they want to drop off their kids so they get a couple hours of rest, or they hit us up for a meal or two. We know that. But it's not up to us to discriminate. It's up to us to have our programs open to all persons. We're here for all of them, like the net. Hopefully, some of it will catch, so to speak. That's not so hard for us. What's more difficult is the idea that at the end of the age, there will be a sorting. That those who have found the kingdom and responded to it and been transformed will be in one category, and those who have not will be in another. Didn't used to bother people to preach that or to teach that, but it seems to bother us today. We've come to this point where, and I'm sure you've heard it, and I know I've heard it all the time, well, God is a loving God and God wouldn't hurt anyone. And to challenge that statement, I'm going to go to the writings of, and I've mentioned him before several times, Miroslav Volf. Miroslav Volf is Croatian, and he and his family lived through the Serbian-Croatian War when there was a massive ethnic cleansing of Croatia. And in fact, his brother was killed by Serbian soldiers when his brother was five. Okay, so he's not taking this lightly when he says this. He says, if God is not a God of judgment and justice, this is a paraphrase, not a quote. If God is not a God of judgment and justice, then there is no justice for those who have been violated and not seen justice in their own lives. How do you bring justice to a five-year-old child that's a victim of the Serbian-Croatian war? And I'm not going to go on and on and on with all the horrors that exist in the world. But if God is not able and willing to set these right, then there is no justice. And we need this kind of justice. We need, particularly the people who have been violated or abused, need to know that God is a God of justice and will bring that justice to them. I rather tend to think that God's justice is a purifying fire that will cleanse us all. But it's not an easy, feel-good process. So at the end of the age, there will be this sorting. And we have no idea how it will turn out. Only God knows. So let's put this together. This treasure, which we call the kingdom of heaven, which I'm calling the gospel, can be stumbled upon in a field. Some people search for it all their life. And it cost us everything. This may be the most difficult turn, actually, in the parables, that it calls for a complete life change. It calls for repentance. It calls for new life. It calls for a completely new way of living. And only in the end will we know who responded. Remember I said in the parables we were not given the response of the people to it? They found it purely by grace in both cases. But how they responded to that grace and how they lived it out is not fully known until the end. I'm going to summarize this by saying how we live matters. The choices we make day to day in our lives matter. The way we respond and interact with people matters. And it matters ultimately. Our faith in Christ is not something that we put on Sunday morning, but it's something that matters in the living out of our lives. That we live as he has called us to live. It matters. After all this, Jesus asked his disciples, "Do you understand this?" And I would ask you the same. Do you understand this? Finding the treasure or the pearl matters. Responding to it matters. And they say yes. And he basically says, go out and teach it to others. Let's pray. Holy God, we know that we live by grace. We know that your love is a purifying fire. And so we turn our lives to you in response to this grace in Jesus Christ. Amen. Now, if you would, if you are able and comfortable, please stand and we will sing hymn number 400, followed by the Apostles' Creed. now if you would turn to page 6 in the bulletin, we will confess our faith together with the Apostles' Creed. The origin of the Apostles' Creed is lost in antiquity, but as far as I know, it is accepted by all major church unions. And it is our faith, it is the Christian faith that we have been handed down from the apostles. So together, let us confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Please be seated. And Jonathan and Sarah and Valerie, if you would come forward. If you would like your family to come with you, that is fine. As we gather for baptism, I'd like to say a word or two about grace. I think that when we, I believe that when we baptize children, we make a very powerful statement about grace. And that statement is that God loves this child fully, 100%, as this child is. Grace is given to us for nothing we have done. This child is pure and innocent and receives God's grace through this sacrament. So now hear the words of our Lord Jesus Christ. He tells us that all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to him. He says, go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Hear also these words from Scripture. There is one body of which we, the church, are a part. There is one Spirit who is present with us this morning as we baptize. One Lord, one faith, one baptism throughout the entire Christian church. One God and Father of us all. And so now, obeying the words of our Lord Jesus Christ and confident of his promises, we baptize Noah. We say that in baptism, God claims us. This is an entry into the new life we talked about. God frees us from our past and opens to us a new future. By water and the Holy Spirit, we were, and Noah will be, made members of the church in the body of Christ.
On behalf of the session,
I present Noah Allen DeLude.
Now, Sarah and Jonathan, I will ask these questions on behalf of Noah. Do you desire that he be baptized?
Yes.
Relying on God's grace, do you promise to live the Christian faith and to teach that faith to him?
Yes.
And now this is a question to the congregation. Do you, as members of the Church of Jesus Christ, promise to guide and nurture Noah Allen DeLude by word and deed, with love and prayer, teaching him to know and follow Jesus Christ, and to be faithful members of this church as you are able, do you? And now I will ask you these questions. Trusting in the gracious mercy of God, do you turn from the ways of sin and renounce evil and its power in the world? Do you? Do you turn to Jesus Christ and accept him as your Lord and Savior, trusting in his grace and love? Do you? Will you be Christ's faithful disciple, obeying his word and showing his love? Will you? And will you be a faithful member of Christ's church, sharing its worship and ministry through your prayers and gifts, your study and service, and so fulfill your calling to be a disciple of Christ, will you? We're not going too far. You're trying to figure out who I am, aren't you? Okay. Noah, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. I wish you could see the look in his eyes. What is going on? Children are precious, so precious, that we bring them into the church by God's grace. So please, welcome Noah. Now we ask that God uphold Noah. We ask that he give him the spirit of wisdom and understanding, spirit of counsel and might, spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, the spirit of joy in God's presence. Let us welcome Noah. And now let us pray. Holy God, we know that you give us the gift of life. We know that you give us life and breath. But we also know that you give us new life in Christ. So whether we stumble upon it or whether we search for it, lead us to that one great gift that gives us eternal life in Christ. Help us then to be your witnesses, that we go out, that we be among people, that we live our lives in your will as Christ lived his life in your will. That we be those who are kind and generous and good and hopeful. Guide us in all our decisions and all our hopes. Lord, we are bold to pray for the whole world. In fact, we are bold to pray that at the end, when you gather your net, and into your net you gather all peoples, that all peoples are purified by your fire and found to be in you. We pray for perfect justice in an imperfect world. And while we are here, we pray that we do what we can to bring this about. And so we pray for the leaders of the world, the leaders of our church, our churches, and each of us, that we become whole and holy in Christ. We pray all this in Christ's name. Amen. Now, if the ushers would come forward, please. Now, great God in heaven, you give us everything, and so we return to you a portion of it as our gifts to you. We ask your blessing on the gifts and the givers in Christ our Lord. Amen. Now we will sing together hymn number 492. This will be followed by a prayer of grace for the food that will follow us, the benediction, and another song. So, 492.
Thank you. found this poem in my mom and dad's stuff, so I thought it applied to today. So, a poem by Barbara Younger says, "Holy God, creator of all life, bless Noah, whom we have sprinkled today with the water of faith and love. Thank you for all new life, for each day, and for food and family and friends. Amen."
Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. For those of you who don't normally worship with us, this song is printed here in the bulletin on page 7. And now, if you would join us downstairs, there is a dinner prepared for us. Thank you.